Gary Patterson has won 109 games at TCU and with one more today becomes the all-time winningest coach in school history. He's won at least 11 games in six of the last seven seasons, igniting frog fever in Fort Worth and a beautiful rebuilt version of Amon Carter Stadium debuting today. TCU takes the field under the banner of the Big 12 for the first time against Doug Williams' Grambling State Tigers, right now on Fox College Football. The best way to christen a new stadium with a jet plane flyover. That's exactly what they've done this afternoon in Fort Worth. Welcome to the new Amon G. Carter Stadium for Fox College Football. Today, the Grambling State Tigers take on the 20th-ranked TCU Horned Frogs. A new conference, a new stadium, and a milestone at stake today for Gary Patterson. And we appreciate you joining us for all of that as we bring you Fox College Football. I'm Mark Folliwell. It is a festive atmosphere today at Amon G. Carter Stadium in Fort Worth. A brilliant last seven-year run has led TCU to this point, but the question is, what happens in the here and now? And for answers to those questions, I bring in my broadcast partner, J.C. Pearson. And one of the questions is, quarterback play, will it get better? Can Casey Paul-Hall improve on his record-breaking season from last year?
Well, they're expecting a big year from Casey Paul-Hall. Had a great season last year, over 2,900 yards passing, 25 touchdowns. They say he's throwing the ball much better now. He's in much, much better shape, and he's really grown and matured in this offense. So much so that now they're allowing him to change plays at the line of scrimmage. That should only mean great things for him in this TCU offense.
All of the buildup and the storylines seem to be about TCU. Grambling State is hoping that they are not just a cameo in this story tonight about TCU. Doug Williams, the legendary former Super Bowl MVP, is their head coach. His son DJ is the quarterback.
And he's a very confident young man, too. He really feels like they have what it takes to win this game, and if so, he's got to be a big part of it. Only threw for 138 yards last week. If they're going to have a chance to win this game tonight, that number's got to be much higher. We'll see if he can get it done.
Grambling State suffered a one-point loss in their opener last week against Alcorn State. Meanwhile, TCU is one of seven FBS teams who did not play last week. But they play tonight in their new digs in Fort Worth. TCU and Grambling coming up next. Fox College Football is presented by Frost Brewed Coors Light, the game's most refreshing beer. By Academy Sports and Outdoors, right stuff, low price every day. And by Ford, it's the Built Ford Tough Truck event at your Texas Ford dealer. Ford is the best in Texas. Fox Sports Southwest College Football, TCU takes on Grambling. It's a season opener and the stadium debut for TCU. Let's check in with our sideline reporter, Emily Jones, with TCU head coach Gary Patterson.
Thank you very much. Well, coach, you had to wait an extra week. What do you want to see out of your team here in the opener?
Well, yeah, everybody, we just want to win. You know, even today there's upsets. So for us, we're just trying to find a way to win and get done what we need to get done.
Coach, thanks for the time. We appreciate it. Best of luck tonight.
That's Doug Williams, the head coach of the Grambling State Tigers, who lost 22-21 last week to Alcorn State in the Port City Classic in Shreveport, Louisiana. They had a 21-9 fourth quarter lead and squandered it because of two fumble punts primarily that set up Alcorn State with great field position.
Can't make those kind of mistakes today against a team like TCU. And he challenged his team early in the week and said this is a character game. He wants to see who can line up and play every play.
With the honors of the first kickoff at TCU's new Amon G. Carter Stadium is true freshman Jaden Overcrom from Arlington Sam Houston High School. His leg proved capable of hitting a 60-yard field goal in high school and a 61-yard field goal in fall practice, and he booms that one to the back of the end zone for a touchback. And now let's look at the Academy Sports and Outdoors right still player for Grambling.
Well, Grambling's going to have to run the football today to try to shorten this game and keep TCU's offense off the field. That means Dorrance Roberts has got to have a big game. Had over 100 yards rushing last week just in the first half. Cramped up, couldn't play in the second half. They've got to have a big game out of him today.
Their fallback option after Roberts was unavailable in the second half was Jeremy Runner, who did, the sophomore, post 13 carries, 93 yards, and one touchdown. DJ Williams to Roberts, and Roberts is nailed at the line of scrimmage. And keep in mind that this year, when kickoffs go into the end zone and are down for a touchback, they come out to the 25-yard line now rather than the 20-yard line.
New rule this year.
DJ Williams, the starting quarterback for Grambling. He's a sophomore, 193 pounds, 6'4", threw for 138 yards and one interception. Handed the ball off with the first play to Dorrance Roberts for 1 yard before starting free safety Elisha Olabo, a junior, made the stop. You just saw number 90 on the TCU defensive front, Stansley Mapunga, the left defensive end and arguably the best player on the TCU defense. Back to pass is DJ Williams, goes sideline and way overthrown and out of bounds. And third and 9 coming up as we look at the Grambling keys to the game, JC.
Well, the first thing for them is they've got to try to establish the run. That's what they do best, and then work the pass off of that. Defensively, they've got a very, very young defensive line that really wore down last week against Alcorn State. That defensive line has got to be better today against TCU.
This is the first ever meeting between TCU and Grambling State. Meanwhile, TCU has never played a team from the SWAC, the Southwestern Athletic Conference, of course, where Grambling resides, and won the conference championship last year, defeating Alabama A&M in the title game. And Dorrance Roberts, who brought up establishing a run as a key, and they did not do that on the first drive. Roberts with an inside handoff and is thrown to the turf by a host of Horned Frog defenders, most notably Devontae Fields, the true freshman at defensive end.
Yeah, and you can just watch how he's just going to collapse and just read the play. Comes down inside, beats the blocker, and just uses his quickness. Devontae Fields, 6'4", 240 pounds, just uses quickness. Comes down the line of scrimmage to make a big play for TCU.
Fabian Carter is punting here. Devontae Fields, by the way, is from Arlington Martin High School, was the third-ranked defensive end by the recruiting services in the state of Texas. And Carter with the punt that will drive the return man back to the 25, cutting upfield to the 30, slipping out of the tackle, headed to his right to the 40, and on the run to the far sideline is Deontay Gray. And hello, New Amon Carter Stadium and the Big 12, and TCU, a 70-yard punt return for Deontay Gray for a touchdown. A true freshman, Deontay Gray, with the punt return for a touchdown. What a way to start his collegiate career. Cale Patterson held for Jaden Overcrom. The extra point is good. And welcome to College Football on Fox. TCU with a punt return for the score. Deontay Gray, a true freshman, announces his presence at TCU with authority, a 70-yard punt return for a touchdown.
No question about it. And on punt returns, if you can make the first couple of guys miss, then you see it normally get a lot of open field. Look at the over pursuit right here by Grambling, and then watch how Deontay Gray just cuts back right there, gets a couple of blocks, and now it's just a foot race. And he's a young man that has a lot of speed. And as a freshman, you get your first punt return, a lot of times it's just running scared and running to open space. And he did a great job of keeping his eyes up, running to open space, great cutback. And that young man's first punt return of his career is a long touchdown.
You know, the interesting thing in talking with head coach Gary Patterson yesterday was his admitted lack of knowing what to expect with this team, JC, because there's so much youth. So many underclassmen make up the roster, and he didn't know what to expect out of them in a first game. And to see a true freshman burst onto the scene with a play like that, that has to obviously exceed his wildest expectations.
No question, especially on special teams. If you can make plays on special teams, that's a huge bonus in any game.
Jaden Overcrom hoping for his second touchback, and that's exactly what will happen. 2 minutes in, TCU up 7-0. Here's Emily.
Well, speaking more to the youth of this team, Gary Patterson saying that it is the youngest team that he will have put on the field in his time at TCU. 102 guys on this roster are either true freshmen, redshirt freshmen, or sophomores. So youth, definitely the theme for this Horned Frog team. But like you said, guys, you got to be, he's got to be impressed with what the youth showed him here early on.
Deontay Gray with a 70-yard punt return for a touchdown. And for the second time in the early going, Grambling will start a drive at their own 25. The last drive netted no yardage. Lawrence Roberts' third carry of the game off the right side. And he finds precious little running room. He is able to fight forward for a 3-yard gain.
Yeah, we talked about how Grambling needs to establish the run, but it's a lot easier said than done. This TCU defense always tough against the run. Last year, they only gave up an average of 124 yards rushing a game, so they're going to be tough.
Let's check the Academy Sports and Outdoors Right Stuff player for TCU.
Yeah, Stansley Mapunga, he's the best player on the field today. Preseason, all Big 12, 9 sacks, 5 forced fumbles last year. They've got to make sure they get him blocked every play.
Second down, inside handoff. Roberts got a favorable spot, so they needed 6 on that second down handoff. And Roberts picks up half of what they need. Kenny Kane, the senior who was TCU's leading tackler with 72 stops last year, is in on that one.
That's what Grambling's got to do. They just have to be patient, take the yards that are there, and then try to get in third and short situations like they're in now. So now the ball can come out of DJ Williams' hands quicker. The rush doesn't have time to get to him, or they can even still possibly run the ball in third and short.
Grambling gained 374 yards last week. 236 of those were on the ground. And that's what they've done so far. 4 rushes, 1 pass, now a second pass attempt. And it's the fullback, O'Shea Hamilton. This is ruled incomplete. The line judge runs in here on Randy Crystal's crew and says that O'Shea Hamilton, who has Metroplex ties, went to high school in both Lancaster and Mesquite. Hamilton, the fullback who caught 1 pass last week, does not hang on to this, so it's an incompletion.
No, definitely a ball that he should have caught, though. Ola Bodie doing a good job, but you can see the ball hits him in the hands, a little behind him, but still a very catchable ball. Those are the kind of plays that Grambling has to make today to be in this ball game. Every play that's there to be made, this kind of ball game, you've got to make it when you're the big underdog.
Deontay Gray back again. The punt by Fabian Carter. Carter is having to serve in the place kicking role as well. We'll talk more about that. Have an opportunity for Grambling to do so presents itself. Here's Casey Pawhall coming on the field. He'll have his first snaps from under center. When we come back, TCU's jumped out to a quick 7-0 lead. College football on Fox. 20th ranked TCU leads Grambling State 7-0. To say that the atmosphere was festive today at the new Amon G. Carter Stadium in Fort Worth might be an understatement. This is obviously a tremendous day for TCU's program. Amon G. Carter Stadium was built in 1930. It opened in a game against Arkansas on October the 11th of 1930. Renovated by HKS Architects out of Dallas for $164 million. New press box, new suites, and of course named after the founder of the Fort Worth Star-Telegram and noted Fort Worth civic booster and activist Amon G. Carter. And in the left flat, a completion here and sidestepping a defender and gaining a first down. Casey Pawhall finds Josh Boyce, who had one of the best years for a receiver in the history of TCU last season when he caught 61 balls for 998 yards. And Casey Pawhall, meanwhile, had one of the best seasons ever for a quarterback at TCU with records in completions, completion percentage, and passing yards.
And I think they'll both have even bigger and better years this year. We talked about Casey in the open, but Josh Boyce, I think he'll get a lot of balls this year.
The gain out to the 41, a play fake to Matthew Tucker, and a pass down the left side, and that is caught. Coming out of the backfield, Wayman James. They've got a two-pronged attack at running back, and they demonstrate not only are they effective using those guys in a running situation, but on the wheel route, here's James.
Yeah, watch number 32 on the wheel route. They just catch Grambling in man-to-man coverage. Just does a great job. Tyler Smith, number 47, never turns his head to find the football. You can
See, that's a great job by Wayman James. Those guys are typically the guys carrying the ball, and they can catch the ball out of the backfield like that.
Marker is down. 10 catches for Wayman James last year. That went for 30 yards. And TCU is marching quickly. Here's Randy Crystal.
32 with contact. 5-yard penalty, first down.
That's David Smith, a 6'2 sophomore at defensive end.
And you got to understand that Grambling right now, probably a little antsy coming into this ball game. Now defense gets hit with two big plays, and then they jump off sides. They just got to settle down and try to play their style of football, see if they can just match up with this offense.
Not even 5 minutes in. A handoff from Matthew Tucker. And Tucker will not make it back to the line of scrimmage. On first and five, they lose a couple of yards. And JC, here's TCU's keys to the game.
Yeah, offensively, they just want to go fast. Tempo, 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 and play faster than Grambling is used to playing defensively. And then on defense for TCU, they just feel like if they don't give up any cheap touchdowns, make Grambling have to put drives together, they don't think that Grambling is good enough to do that, and it's going to be real tough for them to score points today.
A loss of two there for Tucker. Tucker will get the ball again. Slips a tackle to the line of scrimmage into the secondary, and perhaps a touchdown saving tackle. Tucker was about to break away, but Naquan Smith at free safety made a stop before Tucker might have galloped into the end zone.
Yeah, missed tackles really hurt Grambling last week, and watch again. Right here, great job avoiding Tyler Smith, drops his head, the safety, and allows Matt Tucker to get even additional yards.
Matthew Tucker ran for 702 yards last season. He's a senior. Nearly 6 yards per carry. Got into the Grambling State 15 with 6 minutes gone by in the game. And Paul Hall will run the option and toss it. Slipping down the sideline is Wayman James, who caught the ball for 30 yards on this drive. 9 yards gained here, and TCU is the only school with two players on the Doak Walker Award watch list. And there they are, 32 Wayman James, 29 Matthew Tucker.
And when you have two guys like that that are that good of running backs, you can rotate them, keep those guys fresh, and it really pays dividends in the second half. Once the defense starts to get tired, you bring another guy in with fresh legs with that kind of ability, really tough to stop them.
TCU last year averaged 209 rushing yards. Casey Paulhall on the keeper. Lunges for the end zone, doesn't get there, but does pick up a first down, and we'll put the Horned Frogs on the lip of the cup with first and goal.
Yeah, and this is something that he didn't do a lot of last year, is run the football. And just another dimension that he brings to this offense. Again, really matured and grown in this offense. If he can make some plays with his legs also, especially with those two running backs, Tucker and James, you really keep a defense on their heels. They really don't know where to go and what to do, and really isolate guys in space.
Paul Hall is a junior out of Brownwood. He ran it down to the one, sweeping to the left side, trying to get into the end zone. Wayman James does exactly that for a TCU touchdown. Now hold the phone here, because there is a marker down.
Offside, defense, number 88, lined up in the neutral zone. The penalty is declined. Result of the play, touchdown.
That was defensive end Eric Harper, who is a graduate student. He'll play for 1 year at Grambling after playing 4 years at Louisiana Tech. He was in the neutral zone, and Cale Patterson will hold for Jaden Overcrom after the 1 yard touchdown run for Matthew, or for Wayman James. Kick is good. Last year, Wayman James punched it in 6 times on the ground. Numero uno of 2012, TCU in front, 14-0. This is college football on Fox. 6 minutes, 50 seconds off the clock in the first quarter. And Grambling State, they are definitely fearing the Frog right now. 14-0 lead off the 1 yard run by James.
Yeah, great shot here of James's explosiveness and his strength. Look at him put that left foot in the ground right here and explode and get downhill. Right now watch him drop his shoulder with some power, take some contact, and just powers into the end zone. Wayman James, only 203 pounds, but very quick, very fast, very explosive, and also some strength there at the end.
the BMW scoring drive sees TCU go 7 plays, 75 yards, 3 minutes and 11 seconds. Remember that James caught a 30-yard pass out of the backfield for the biggest yardage gain on that drive. James punched it in 6 times last year. He's from Sherman, a junior from Sherman, who last year was 8th in the country in yards per rush attempt at 7.2 per carry. Only needed one, but really, as you noted, demonstrated great ability taking it in from a yard out.
Yeah, no question. Again, just plant that foot, one cut, and get downhill immediately. That's what all good running backs are able to do.
Jaden Overcrom. The first possible return, a fumble at the goal line, but Grambling will run it out. And just outside the 10-yard line is Justin Fortson. Fortson, from here, it looked like, J.C., he was thinking about the return before he secured the ball at the goal line.
Yeah, and no question, and with that muff, he could have stayed in the end zone.
Yes.
And down that football. A little panic there. He's got to understand that just because you touch it and you muff it, you don't have to bring it out. Would have been wise for him just to take a knee in the end zone.
Well, the return game is an area where Grambling struggled last week with a couple of turnovers that led to the comeback scores for Alcorn State and the Port City Classic in Shreveport. There's Doug Williams, head coach of the Grambling State Tigers. Played for the legendary Eddie Robinson back in the 70s. Super Bowl MVP with Washington. Heavy pressure. DJ Williams hit as he throws, and it's intercepted at the 25. There's a return. This is Elijah Olabode, and he will score. Touchdown for TCU. 28 yards on the return.
DJ Williams gets a little pressure, but Olabode, number 6, watch him. Playing zone coverage, just reading the eyes and the route of DJ Williams, and then just steps right in and picks that ball off and then just takes it to the house for 6. But when they're playing zone coverage, DJ Williams, and that's what Doug's talking to him about right now, you can't eye the receivers down.
21-0 on the Overcrom extra point. 7:54 left in the first quarter. TCU has an offensive touchdown, a special teams touchdown, and now a defensive touchdown, up 21-0. 21-0 TCU college football on Fox. TCU was one of 3 FBS schools with 3 or more pick sixes in each of the last 2 years. Maryland and Tulsa are the other 2. And Elisha Olivo just had one of the Brown hand center. Great hands of the game, JC.
Yeah, you see him, number 6, just playing center field, reads the route, and just jumps under it. DJ Williams never sees him. Great job jumping the route, seeing the ball thrown, and the rest is easy from there.
Cedar Hill High School making his first collegiate start, Elisha Olivo. He's had a big hit on defense. He almost forced a fumble. Remember that play where O'Shea Hamilton, the fullback, didn't secure a pass that he should have caught. It was Olabode who separated him from the ball. Played for the Cedar Hill Longhorns, making his first start. Did play in 24 games the last 2 years, but always a different feeling when you're taking the field for the first play of the game, and he is making his presence felt.
Early in this ball game.
And that's Jeremy Runner who fumbles the kickoff. Picked it up with the 6, buried at the 10. Flag is down as well. Everything is going wrong for Grambling here in the first 7 minutes and change. Randy Crystal, the referee, and the crew will discuss. Doug Williams, the head coach of the Grambling State Tigers.
Illegal block in the back. Number 33 on the receiving team. Half the distance to the goal, first and 10.
That will back up Grambling as we go down to the sideline to Emily Jones.
Well, as you know, the TCU Horned Frogs waiting a week to start the regular season. Gary Patterson said he took that opportunity to watch at least a half of every other Big 12 team in action. He said it was also an opportunity to run kind of a simulated game week and get some kinks out of the system, especially considering the youth of this team.
TCU is one of 7 teams in FBS that did not play last weekend. The last team to get started ends up being Louisiana Tech, playing later this evening at Houston. Army, Cincinnati, Louisiana, Monroe were all scheduled to be off last weekend. A&M, Louisiana Tech, Oregon State all saw games that were postponed. Of course, we know about A&M and La Tech, Oregon State, and Nicholls State postponed in the aftermath of Hurricane Isaac as well. A loss of a yard, maybe a half yard on the first down run there by Dorrance Roberts. They'll give it to him again. And the best gain so far in the game for Grambling, as surging forward, that was actually Jeremy Runner, the sophomore. Runner carries the ball out to the 10-yard line for a gain of 5.
Yeah, their big thing now is just try to get some first downs and just try to. Pocket, rolling him out, trying to get him away from some of that pressure and giving him a two-way go, either throw or run, to try to make some yards.
Grambling has snapped it 9 times. They have 12 total yards so far. They need 5 on third down. DJ Williams has not completed a pass to a teammate. He rolls, he throws, incomplete.
And they run a one-man route that time. There is nobody in the route except Musa Mahmoud. There's no other receiver that even releases down the field. He has a tough time getting off of bump and run coverage, and absolutely nobody else for DJ Williams to even possibly throw the ball to.
He did hook up with Musa Mahmoud for 85 yards on 3 catches last week, including a 65-yard pass play, the longest play from scrimmage last week against Alcorn.
Yeah, but tough against this defense when you only have one guy in the in the route. You would think they want to spread this TCU defense out and try to give them some more options.
Fabian Carter punting his third. Drives Deontay Gray back to the 40. We've already seen Gray return one. There's a marker down. He stayed on his feet. But there's a marker down in a situation where you would think this will be some sort of penalty on the return, on the blocking on the return for TCU. Yeah, this will be a hole here against TCU on the return.
Holding receiving team, number 41. 10-yard penalty, first down. Number 16's helmet came off. He must leave the game for one play.
It's a new rule this year, by the way. Jonathan Anderson, a safety with the hold.
Yeah, you're going to watch number 41 just coming to your screen. You see that right there. Just a grab right there. That's an easy call right in front of the official. He's hearing about it, obviously.
Well, that is one of the few hiccups so far for TCU in the first 9 minutes. The penalty moves them back to their own 33, where Casey Paul-Hall and company will start the drive. And Paul-Hall on the handoff. Big hole, Raymond James down the sideline. He already has one touchdown run. This will be a big run, and there may be more tacked on. That might have been a horse collar tackle by Naquan Smith. I don't see a marker down, but it was very close to it. A horse collar.
You can see just not good sound run fits for Grambling. Watch the missed tackle right there. And now you let a guy out the gate with that kind of speed. Wayman James, we've seen him make big plays this entire first quarter, but just have to be sounder in your run fits and then make the tackle. And Grambling just hasn't been able to do that yet this first quarter.
Wayman James, a 46-yard run. Caught a 30-yard pass. He has a 1-yard touchdown run. TCU at the Grambling State 21. Paul rifles it over the middle. It's caught. Brandon Carter. The route is on early.
Way too easy. Once Brandon Carter was able to get up on the safety, he had a 2-way go. He could have either gone to the corner or to the post, went to the post, and Paul Hall put it right on the numbers. Safety had no chance to make the play.
Brandon Carter with 3 touchdown catches last year. And Cale Patterson is able to get the snap down for a hold. Overcrom makes it 28-0 after the 21-yard pass. Casey Paul Hall to Brandon Carter.
Yeah, watch Brandon Carter, number 3. Once he gets up on the safety,
he's got a two-way go. He cuts to the inside, and Paul Hall puts that ball right on the money and right on time. Let's that ball go as soon as he comes out of his break, and the safety has no chance to come downhill. The inside backer is caught too short, and it's an easy throw and catch.
And it makes it 28-0 TCU over Grambling State. For a Mazda game break, let's join Rick Renner.
Aggies open up SEC play at home against Florida. Fourth Gator sensation Mike Gillisley scores from 12 yards out. Aggies lose 20-17 despite having another fourth quarter lead. That's your Mazda game break, Mark.
Now Florida goes into A&M for the opener for Texas A&M with the postponement last week. Their first game of the SEC, and Florida rallies here at the new Amon G. Carter Stadium in Fort Worth. Practically everything has gone TCU's way, and Justin Fortson downs it in the end zone for Grambling. Another touchback as the Tigers have endured a first 10 minutes, 9 minutes, 40 seconds to be exact, that probably has them shell-shocked right now.
No question about it. Now they just have to try to figure out what they can execute. You know, they're not even worried or shouldn't be worried about the score at this point. Just get some first downs. Right. Just keep the clock moving a little bit, try to shorten the game and keep TCU's offense off of the field. So they've got to try to figure out what they can execute.
Grambling has played a Big 12 team one other time. That was in 2009. And the score was pretty ugly in that game. They lost to Oklahoma State 56-6. Jeremy Runner with room around the left side, surging forward for what I believe is now the biggest play from scrimmage for Grambling in the game. John Lewis, the defensive tackle, stops Jeremy Runner after a 7-yard run.
And a good lead block by the fullback, O'Shea Hamilton, just coming around it with the kick out block. But those are the kind of plays that they've got to run. You know, they're a running football team first. We've seen what happened when they've tried to come out and throw the ball. Not a lot of good things. So they're going to come out and see if they can establish something in this run game.
They've thrown the ball four times. They've yet to complete a pass. DJ Williams also threw a pick six that Elisha Olabo had returned 28 yards for a touchdown. What's happening here is, as Jonathan Anderson stops Jeremy Runner, is what should be Grambling's first down of the game. Just past the 35-yard line, what they needed. They moved the chains for the first time with well over 10 minutes played in the first quarter.
Yeah, and once they start doing that and force TCU to bring in an extra guy down in the box because they think run, well, now they can play action pass and hopefully their wide receivers. That was one of the questions that Doug Williams had for his receivers. Could they beat bump and run coverage? Are they good enough to do that? And you see they're getting a lot of it, and they're going to have to win outside.
A collision between DJ Williams and the fullback of the backfield, and Runner surges ahead for a yard. We'll see a lot of substitutions, a lot of fresh legs on the defensive line. Chucky Hunter, a sophomore who was behind John Lewis on the depth chart, Hunter is in to make that stop.
You know, we talked to Gary Patterson about this defense, and we asked him, you know, what is your philosophy this year? What kind of style are you guys going to play? And he really wasn't sure yet. Said they had so many young guys and new guys, they were going to use this game to try to figure out who they are defensively. Now, obviously, right now, everything going their way.
And you just saw a moment ago as DJ Williams fumbles the snap and gets back on it. To Patterson's right on the sideline a moment ago was Dick Bumpus, the defensive coordinator. Ninth year as the defensive coordinator here at TCU, and they led the NCAA in total defense for three straight years, 08, 09, and 2010. And he is a veteran of the college football sidelines, 30 years as a college assistant.
And they've done it in different ways. They've been an attacking, blitzing style of defense. They've been a zone defense. So they really tailor make their defense to the talents of their players. And that's why he said, you know, they really weren't sure what they were going to be this year. But, you know, they've been very good defensively, and they've done it in a number of different ways over the years.
Blackout.
Offense. 5-yard penalty. Third down
just got tougher from 12 yards needed, pushed back out to 17 now.
Yeah, you know, they come out and they get a first down, and then they start to shoot themselves in the foot. They run into each other in the backfield. on first down. They fumble the snap on second down, and then they get a penalty on third down. So when you're playing against a team like TCU, you can't afford those kind of things and put yourself in these situations, because only bad things can happen to you.
Grambling 5 penalties for 40 yards last week, and the 1-point loss to Alcorn State. They drop back into coverage on defense. TCU, and off the edge, Devontae Fields. It was his pressure that forced a poor throw by DJ Williams, leading to the interception return earlier. And there's the sack, losing 7 yards. Fields blasting DJ Williams.
Yeah, if you want to see what a speed rush looks like, watch Devontae Fields down here come off the edge. Just use his speed and quickness and just comes right off the edge and hits DJ Williams in the back. Anthony Cherry, the left tackle, has actually just no chance. Actually, that was Quentin Roberts, number 73, no chance.
Davion Pearson got into the mix, too. Now, there is a punt that bounced off a Grambling player, 41 yards, as we just saw the first punt of the game, or the fourth punt of the game, rather, for Carter for Grambling.
How about Wayman James? He's done a little bit of everything in this first quarter. Comes out with the wheel route and catches the ball, runs here with power, and then how about a little quickness right here and some power at the end. Finishes off a touchdown and then breaks one tackle right there, gets to the outside, and now he's able to show his speed. Wayman James, obviously one of the best backs in the country, and they've got two of them here at TCU, and they just keep rotating them in and out, having a great first quarter.
Leading rusher for TCU last year, Wayman James, the junior from Sherman, ran for 875 yards last year. Honorable mention, all Mountain West. Their last season of the Mountain West, the last of 7 years, now in the Big 12. Run by Matthew Tucker, stopped by David Smith. In those 7 years in the Mountain West, by the way, TCU averaged 11 wins per season. They won 77 games. And that is what has ignited Frog Fever, and everybody like that fan we just saw wearing their purple. He's taken it to an extreme, but obviously Frog Fever and purple is the dominant color of Fort Worth.
Oh, no question. And of course, everybody's wondering how they're going to do week in and week out in the Big 12. I don't have those questions. I think they're going to be just fine.
4-yard gain by Tucker, delivering a bullet over the middle to Cam White. Casey Pawhall, nice pass. White secures it. Tyler Smith, the tackle, but the chains move again. An 18-yard pass play.
And how about White just plucking the ball with his hands? He's in traffic, but he doesn't let the ball come to his body. He reaches out and plucks it with his hands. That's what you want all receivers to do, especially going through traffic.
Cam White last year caught 6 passes, 90 yards from DeSoto, a sophomore. Remember that Sky Dawson is not on the field tonight for TCU, suspended for a team rules violation. This is the first time that Andre Dean has touched the ball on a run tonight. Dean is 3rd on the depth chart for TCU after Matthew Tucker and Wayman James, but number 30, Dean with the run there for TCU. He's a senior from Katy.
And he'll get some playing time because they really like to play 3 running backs. They had Ed Wesley last year, and all 3 of those guys had over 700 yards. They really like to have and go 3 deep at the running back spot and rotate all 3 of those guys and keep those legs fresh.
6 yards on that run. And the line judge will come in here.
The end of the first quarter.
First quarter is over. TCU did not get the snap off before the end of the first, and they dominate the first 15 minutes of the game. TCU with a defensive touchdown, a special teams touchdown. They've run one in, they've thrown one in. 28-0. TCU, 20th ranked in the country, leads Grambling State. You're watching Fox College Football. Second quarter about to start at the new Amon Carter Stadium in TCU's Big 12 debut. They lead Grambling State 28-0 as we go to the sideline, and Emily Jones.
TCU coaches talked about Casey Pawhall and the maturity that he developed in the offseason. He said he needed to do a better job preparing every week, regardless of the opponent. And with that, the coaches gave him a little more freedom as far as checking things off at the line. Offensive coordinator Jared Anderson said, "We did communicate, though, as quickly as we gave it to him, we could take it away." So he seems to be off to a good start, guys.
Indeed, he does. Mark Falwell, J.C. Pearson in the booth on the call as the pass is complete. Paul Hall to Cam White, and he is upended by Devontae Hogan. But it will move the chains, and for Paul Hall, it's another completion. He's now 5 of 5, pass for 95 yards. By the way, a correction on the last run of the first quarter. It was Matthew Tucker carrying again. We do expect to see Andre Dean into the game, although he did not get that 6-yard carry on the final play of the first quarter. It was Tucker. Empty backfield, but now they'll bring Waymon James across. Paul Hall hands it off to him. And around left end, another nice gain for the TCU running game. David Smith brings down James, but he picks up a first down on an 11-yard run.
Yeah, and they can be so multiple offensively. You see Waymon James lines up in the slot. They go five receivers. Then he comes in motion, and now he's a running back, and now he takes the jet sweep, and now he's got two blockers out in front of him. So they can do a number of different things from their personnel groupings that really can keep Grambling off balance.
Waymon James has run for 67 yards and also has a 30-yard pass catch. And there is Dean. He does get into the game. And his first carry of the season ends up being a 5-yard gain as he spun off a tackle. And Wade Julian, who had 13 tackles against Alcorn State last week, brings down Dean. That included two tackles for loss for the weak side linebacker for Grambling.
Yeah, and the weakness of this Grambling defense is up front. Right. Their defensive line, they're young, they're inexperienced. That, you know, we talked to Andre Robinson, the defensive coordinator. He said, you know, they want to be a gap control defense, but they have trouble getting lined up correctly, and guys have too many mental errors. And right now they're losing the battle at the line of scrimmage.
Inside handoff, and they win a battle at the line of scrimmage as Dean got stuffed. You know, yesterday I talked to Jacardi Carter, the middle linebacker for Grambling, and one thing he said about his guys up front, one thing that they learned last week, and there's so many inexperienced guys and true freshmen playing, is they can play up higher as defensive linemen in high school, realize got to get down lower at this level, and that's something he felt like they did a better job of in practice this week in preparation.
No question. Low man wins in football, and when you get high, especially on the front, you get blown off the ball. That time Centurio Ford, number 98, makes a good play, but alignment, assignment, and technique got to be sound in those three areas.
First third down snap of the game for TCU. They got backed up a yard, and they needed seven, but they got more than that. They got the end zone for a touchdown as Josh Boyce catches from Paul Hall, 12 yards.
Just a great quick read, too, by Paul Hall. Josh Boyce left uncovered in the slot. Just an easy, quick throw. Pressure has no time to get to Paul Hall. That's just too easy.
5 for 5 for Obercrom on extra points. Another TD pass for Paul Hall and Josh Boyce.
Just too easy. Just a quick throw. Watch Paul Hall at the end.
Grambling did bring quite a few folks up on the 4-hour bus ride, including the world-famed Grambling Tiger Marching Band, who will perform at halftime, and we'll show some of that to you. Here's the 12-yard touchdown pass to Josh Boyce.
Yeah, watch Wade Julian, the outside backer, rush. Paul Hall sees it right now, and they void the zone. Either the safety, Tyler Smith, doesn't come down fast enough, or somebody blew that coverage, and just too easy. Casey Paul Hall, a veteran quarterback, sees it right now and just gets it to Boyce, and he does the rest.
And makes another move up the ladder for career receiving touchdowns at TCU. He's from Central Texas, from Coppers Cove High School. He's on the Biletnikoff Award watch list. And he had one of the best overall seasons ever for a TCU wide receiver last year, as he was 3 catches short of the school record, 14 yards short of the school receiving yards record, and 1 touchdown shy of tying the school record in receiving TDs in a season when he found the end zone 9 times, finds it for the first time this year. A short kick fielded by Fortson running up to the 6, broke out of a tackle, got past the 20, and then was brought down on special teams by TCU. 17 yards on the return. Here's Rick Renner with a Mazda game break.
Thanks, Mark. In Norman, Oklahoma plays its first home game. Sooners looking great. D.D. Williams scores his second touchdown of the game. 14-0 OU over Florida A&M.
And here Grambling has the ball at their own 24, trailing TCU, 20th ranked in the nation, 35-0. From the 24, Grambling a first down with Jeremy Runner in the backfield. He gets stood up, but fights forward to the 30-yard line. A gain of 6, Elisha Olabode, who has been all over the place defensively, along with Devontae Fields, who has had an equally impactful performance tonight. They team up on the tackle, among others. Kenny Kane was in there also.
No question, but a good tough run there for Jeremy Runner. Gets 5-6 yards there. As long as they can stay getting positive yards and not get the negative yards, the sacks, the missed snaps and tackles for losses, then they can try to keep these chains moving, trying to keep forward getting first downs. And again, I think what they ought to try to do is get DJ Williams on the edges some more, try to give him a two-way go, see if he can either make something with the pass or the run.
Left guard Ashton Green for Grambling State has gone out of the game, the 6'4", 330-pound senior. Run of 6, second down 4. TCU just had an 8-play, 63-yard scoring drive. And here is a big rush. DJ Williams, deep ball, hit as he throws, incomplete. It's broken up. Anthony McGee was the intended receiver. And Jason Verrett, one of two very fine starting corners for the TCU defense. Verrett is back there to break it up.
Yeah, great play by Verrett. DJ Williams gets some pressure here at the end, but throws that ball out there. If he can just get it out in front a little more, that would be great. But Jason Verrett, number 2, watch him play the football. Avoids contact with the receiver, comes over the shoulder, and almost comes up with the pick.
There is probably a substitution, a 12 men on the field.
Grambling, it's their first timeout.
Well, the timeout was called before as the flag was about to hit the turf. There's a timeout. It's all TCU early in the second, 35-0. Fox College Football is presented by Academy Sports and Outdoors. Right stuff, low price, every day. And by Ford. It's the Built Ford Tough Truck event at your Texas Ford dealer. Ford is the best in Texas. Debut of new Amon G. Carter Stadium. First game under the banner of the Big 12. Gary Patterson trying to become TCU's all-time winningest head football coach. That is the backdrop for this one this evening. Thank goodness that front moved through last night, by the way. Much more pleasant day for football. TCU has outgained Grambling 200 yards to 21 yards, outscored them 35-0. Grambling has not converted in 4 third down attempts. They might here. They need 4 on that pass play on the left side to Richard Wilson. He comes up a little bit short, though. Kenny Kane, the strong side linebacker, brings down Wilson, who made his second grab of the season.
Yeah, and it doesn't look like the punt team is coming on the field. Look like they're going to be aggressive. Oh, they gave him the first down.
He got a good spot.
Yeah, I thought he was a little bit short.
So it's a 4-yard gain. They needed 4. And that's what they get. The first completion for DJ Williams. First 5 passes were incomplete. And that includes an interception that Elisha Olabode ran in for a touchdown. Big hit in the backfield. There's Devontae Fields. And he devours Jeremy Runner. Stanley Maponga, that is, was in there also.
Well, yeah, and they didn't block either defensive end. You're going to see Fields here in Maponga, and watch both guys get in on the tackle. Fields just jumps inside, makes the play. Nobody blocks Maponga on the backside. I mean, you got to block him. I mean, when we talk to the Grambling coaches, they said, we've got to make sure that we know where 90 is every play and block him, and then where number two, Jason Verrett, is in coverage. They absolutely turned Mapunga loose that time, and that's not a good thing.
Loss of two there. Mapunga had 13 and a half tackles for loss last year, and he teamed up with Devontae Fields on that one for a two-yard loss. On second and 12, Jeremy Runner carries the ball for four. A little bit more about Stanley Mapunga. For his five fumbles last year, had nine quarterback sacks. And he is the only preseason all-Big 12 conference selection for TCU. Junior wears number 90 on that TCU defense. They're down and eight for Grambling. They're on 36. Mapunga with the rush, down he goes, sacks DJ Williams.
You got to get him blocked. You can't single block him. He is too good. We talked about him at the beginning that he's the best player on the field today. You're going to see him just come off. He has does a great job just with speed. They tried to double team him. They tried to get Jeremy Runner to come over and help, and he just beats both of them and gets the sack.
First sack of the season, as noted, he had nine last year. Fabian Carter has averaged 44 yards on his previous four punts. Deontay Gray will let it hit. Squirts to the sideline. 45-yard punt for Carter for Grambling. TCU is in control. A 35-0 lead at home against Grambling State. College football on Fox. A lot for TCU to cheer about with a 35-0 lead with 8:39 left in the second quarter. Doug Williams, not so much to cheer about. The head coach of the Grambling State Tigers. This is his second tour of duty as the head coach of Grambling. Remember that he replaced the legendary Eddie Robinson back in the late 90s, but of course, he played for Robinson in the 70s. SWAC Player of the Year in 1977, first team AP All-American, fourth at Heisman Trophy voting, over 8,400 yards passing, 93 touchdowns. He was a first round draft pick by the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. He played in the USFL and then came back to the NFL with the Washington Redskins and was the most valuable player of their Super Bowl 22 route of the Denver Broncos. Out of the timeout, Paul Hall throws for the 24, finds Josh Boyce for a gain of 8 yards on the pitch and catch. For more on Doug Williams, here's Emily Jones.
Well, Doug Williams, you mentioned his storied career as a player at Grambling State. They had five opportunities during his time to play Division I schools. They went 4-1 in that time. He said it's a mindset that we have to recreate. The fact that we can not only hang with these guys, but we can actually beat them. It's the mindset we had in the late 70s, and it's something we've got to get going if we're going to be competitive in games like this.
During that time, they beat Hawaii a couple of times. They played a bowl game in Japan against Temple. A handoff on second and short. They need two. Had a run to the left side for Matthew Tucker.
And he challenged his guys this week. You know, he told them that this is a character game for them. You know, they're still learning about their team and their players. And he said they want to see who wants to come out and really play and play hard every play. And the ones that don't probably won't be around playing for Grambling very much longer. But this is a game that he wanted to really find out about his team and his players and what kind of heart they had.
No gain for Tucker on the run a moment ago. Two tight ends are in right now for TCU, lined up on the right. 86 Corey Fuller, 87 Griffin Gilbert. A handoff and diving for the first down right at the sticks. Raymond James, Wade Julian on the tackle. Very close on that third down run by James.
Yeah, defensively, you know, they knew that they were going to have to try to really sell out. So they're playing a lot of man coverage, and they said that they were going to play more than they probably wanted to because they're going to have to commit more guys to trying to stop the run. And now that they're doing that, and, you know, look for Paul Hall and TCU to try to take advantage of some of those one-on-ones on the outside.
Last year, TCU third in the nation. 52% their third down conversion rate. They're 2-for-2 tonight after that short run. James got just enough. Play fake, Paul Hall finds Josh Boyce. Boyce turns it up the field, breaking tackles and off to the races. Gets a downfield block, cuts all the way across the field, and will beat up to the corner for the end zone. It's a touchdown, 66 yards. Paul Hall to Boyce.
Well, one thing you can't coach is speed. And Josh Boyce has a lot of it, a 4-3 guy in the 40. That's why you just want to get the ball out quick to guys like him. Let him do the rest. Ball Hall just throws that quick bubble screen, and Josh Boyce in that 4-3 40 speed just outruns everybody else on that Grambling defense.
Broke out of a couple of tackles. Got a good block downfield from redshirt freshman Ladarius Brown.
And watch, just a quick throw outside. And now it's just speed. Look at him run away. He gets one block down the field from his other wide receiver. And now a great cut right here. Another crackback block. And then once he cuts back across the field, it's all speed. And you can see he's got a couple more blockers down the field helping him. But you can't account for speed.
Casey Paul Hall having a great night, to say the least. He's now 8 of 8, 179 yards, and very, very happy for his teammate Josh Boyce, who is 102 receiving yards. Here's the run after catch again.
Yeah, and it's been easy for Paul Hall, just get the ball out of his hands quickly to the playmakers. And you can see Josh Boyce, once he breaks back across the field, there's nobody from Grambling that can catch him. Got a couple great blocks out front from his fellow wide receivers, and then he was off to the races.
42-0 on the extra point by Jaden Obercrom. And so with that, Josh Boyce now shares the TCU all-time lead in receiving touchdowns. Corey Rogers, of course, the most recent name on the list, but I think most everyone remembers Mike Renfro, the Fort Worth native.
No doubt.
Former Houston Oiler and Dallas Cowboy. All three, Josh Boyce, Corey Rogers, Mike Renfro, with 17 touchdown receptions in their respective TCU careers. And obviously Boyce as a junior with a long time to add on to that total and set a new mark in the TCU record books.
Yeah, he's going to put that mark way out there and might do that before this game is over here tonight. The way he's catching the ball and running, he definitely has a great shot of breaking that record tonight at least.
Caught 34 passes for 646 yards back in 2010. He was a real big play threat. 19 yards per catch that year, was 10th in the NCAA. Then last year, 61 catches, 998 yards, 9 touchdowns. And he is having a big night tonight. Now, we have seen Obercrom handle the kicking duties, but they'll go with sophomore Ryan DiNucci. And this situation, TCU will. And he gets a lot of it 3 yards deep into the end zone. TCU leads at 42-0 in the second quarter. This college football season, Fox Sports is proud to partner with the Prostate Cancer Foundation, the world's largest supporter of prostate cancer research. 1 in 6 American men will be diagnosed with prostate cancer in their lifetime. To learn more, please visit www.pcf.org/foxsports. ,12-2 advantage in first downs for TCU. 276-22 advantage in total yardage. 42-0 advantage on the scoreboard. Grambling is averaging 1 yard per play compared to TCU's 13 yards per play. And Grambling gets something positive happening here. They do get a completion as DJ Williams throws it out of the left side. And Grambling gets the catch. We see Jeremy Hernandez from Mesquite.
And that's the only way that they can throw the ball, is quick three-step drops and get the ball out of his hands, because anything more than that, and the pass rush from TCU has been on him this entire ball game. So when they're throwing the ball, it's got to be 1, 2, 3, get the ball out of his hands.
8 yard gain. Devontae Fields has hit DJ Williams in the backfield on the rush tonight. So is Stansley Mapunga. He sacked him. He took a big shot from John Lewis. Inside handoff, lose yardage. There's Devontae Fields again, the true freshman. What a game he is having as he gets his first chance to set foot on the field in college football, and he brings down runner for a 2-yard loss.
Devontae Fields has had a great first half. He's a kid that was offered from schools all across the country, big schools, chose to come here to TCU and making his impact felt right away.
Yeah, keep in mind, as we noted earlier, if you are into this sort of thing, the recruiting services had him ranked as high as the number 3 defensive end in Texas. Third down and 4, and they will not pick it up. Jeremy Runner on the carry, and Elisha Olabode comes in to make the tackle. It will be 4th and just less than a yard for Grambling.
Yeah, and they're keeping the offense on the field.
Clock running under 5 minutes left in the first half.
Looks like there's some communication issues here. They're going to have to take a timeout.
And they'll take that timeout with 4 minutes, 44 seconds remaining in the second quarter. It's been all TCU. They jumped on Grambling early, and they lead it 42-0. The timeout, Grambling taking their 2nd of 3 here in the first half. 4th and inches is what they have coming up.
Yeah, and I think they want to try to hard count TCU and see if they can get them to jump off sides. You can read lips down there. He's going to say that, you know, try to nobody move, hut. But then I think after that, they may end up snapping the ball because he said we only have 6 inches to go. So look for a hard count first, and if nobody moves, maybe they'll snap it and go for it.
4th down. Grambling hasn't been able to stop TCU on defense, so they might as well go for it here.
There's the hard counts that we were talking about. They end up taking the timeout.
Are you surprised that they took the timeout? There was still 8 seconds left on the play clock. They didn't try more to draw him offside.
Well, I think the upset part right now with Doug is that, yeah, he's saying, why did you call timeout? You can see him right there. And I think he wanted the quarterback to be more demonstrative on the huts to try to draw him offsides. And then he didn't want the timeout. He didn't want the time, like you were saying, surprised.
And he took the timeout with 8 seconds. And I think what we're seeing right now, JC, among many things, is the challenge of father having to coach son.
Yeah, and just being a young team. And because if you're going to punt the ball away, why waste the timeout? Take the 5-yard penalty, and you're still punting it anyway.
6th time tonight that Fabian Carter is punting for Grambling. Driving back, Deontay Gray makes a tough catch at his own 22. Eludes 2 tackles. And then a swarm of white shirts on special teams will bring down Gray at his own 34 as we go to the sideline to Emily Jones.
Well, if you want more evidence of the youth of this TCU football team, Gary Patterson already played 9 true freshmen tonight. That's the most in a single season. The previous record was 6, which he played last year in 2011. Among those, Avion Collins, who is the first true freshman to start on the O-line under Gary Patterson. A lot of firsts here tonight, gentlemen.
Indeed. Deontay Gray, number 20 right there, just returned the punt on his first touch of the ball as a true freshman. Had a 70-yard punt return for a touchdown with a 1:59 gone by in the game. Big hit in the backfield. Trey Williams at linebacker.
That's what they need. Trey Williams, number 42, just comes off the edge. Unblocked, aggressive, and makes the tackle for a loss. And those are the kind of players that Doug Williams is looking for.
And another freshman in the game for TCU. The handoff went to B.J. Catalan. Just the 2nd play for negative yardage for TCU so far in the game. Catalan, not negative yardage this time. squirts up field through a hole in the middle and has the first down and more out beyond the 45 to the 47. He'll gain 16.
Yeah, this TCU offensive line is going to come right at you. They do a good job of just getting a man on a man, block out, block down, and then look at the lane. Nobody at the second level doesn't get touched until he gets to the safeties, but TCU doing a great job of identifying where those defensive players are and getting a man on a man.
Catalan was enrolled in school early enough to participate in spring practice, and there was no doubt in talking to TCU coaches yesterday that this is not going to be a freshman, that they want a redshirt. They want to develop that third running back. It could be Catalan who comes on this year. It could be Andre Dean, whose name we've mentioned earlier tonight, who has a carry. But three straight carries for Catalan, and he gains four on that run.
Yeah, and it could be all four of those guys eventually, because they all have a lot of talent, speed, quickness, explosion, as we've seen tonight. The fresher they can keep in all those guys, the better off they'll be.
The Grambling 49 flares it out, and it's Catalan showing the speed and the toughness as he maneuvers it down the field to the 30 into the 27. 22-yard pass play, Paul Hall to B.J. Catalan.
And really got some great blocks out front, starting with Brandon Carter, number three. And then look at the lineman down there, John Woolridge, number 75, all the way downfield making blocks. And then look at that, running with power, spinning off, and making additional yards. And if you're Grambling, you're telling Tyler Smith, 47, you got to wrap up. You can't just go in and shoulder tackle these guys. They're too good to do that.
And once again, these true freshmen playing tonight for TCU continue to be a story. Big hole for Andre Dean on first down. He gains 12 on the run. Naquan Smith stops him at the Grambling State 15 with a minute 59 left in the half.
And what we're seeing now is just dominance up front. They just run the counter. And look at, he's looking for somebody to block. Nobody even there. And you don't see any white jerseys at the second level until he's 6 yards down the field. What we're seeing right now is just this defensive line of Grambling, that's their weakness coming in, just completely worn down already in this first half.
Officially 11 yards on the run. And Andre Dean fighting forward. Thought the play was about to be blown dead when he was stacked up at the 14, but was able to push the pile forward for a couple more yards. TCU is closing in on 130 rushing yards in the first half, and Paul Hall, who you see right there, number four, the quarterback, has thrown for 201.
The offensive line just doing a great job, just getting push at the line of scrimmage on this young, inexperienced defensive line of Grambling, and they really ran out of gas at the end of their game against Alcorn last week. And you know, this week the tempo has just been way too much and too fast for him this first half.
Oh, Paul Hall fumbles the snap. One of the few negative plays in this game for TCU. Paul Hall fumbles on the center exchange with James Fry. Now that's Joey Hunt in the game.
And just never got the ball. Does a great job of pulling the ball away there to recover the fumble. But you never want to see a center quarterback exchange problem.
Lost a yard. Paul Hall was able to get back on the ball for TCU as they have all three of their timeouts. They're running the clock down here. And as a matter of fact, they will just let this run all the way to the end of the half. So Gary Patterson will bring his team together for a huddle to talk before they head back to the locker room. 42 to nothing is TCU's lead over Grambling State. Now we've got a busy halftime show coming up here in just a moment. We're looking at Big 12 action. Kansas State taking on Miami. Rock Shock Jayhawk. What happened to the Kansas Jayhawks against the Rice Owls? Rick Renner and Pat Jones will fill you in on that. And we will show you performances from the bands, from TCU and, of course, the world-famed Grambling State marching band. Down on the field, Emily and Gary Patterson.
Thank you, Coach. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but could this have gotten off to a better start for your team?
Oh, no. You know, especially, you know, it's waiting as long as we've waited to play the ball game. But we got a second half. You got to be careful in these games of getting people hurt.
So what we got to do is we got to come out and still play. Hopefully we'll get our number two quarterback in, start of the second half, and do the things we need to do.
What about the rest of your guys? Because you are so young, will you play your starters more?
No, we'll keep doing it. You know, everybody's played. We got to get ready for the season. So for us, it's all about winning by 1 point. Obviously, we're going to win hopefully by a couple more tonight. We got to get everybody ready to go.
Coach, thanks for the time. We appreciate it. Congratulations on a great first half. Still another half to play here in Fort Worth. We'll have the college football halftime show with Rick Renner and Pat Jones coming up after the break.
Good job by our crew putting together the sights and sounds of the first half of TCU's 42-0 lead over Grambling State. College football on Fox. If you're watching in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex, we're on Fox Sports Southwest Plus tonight as we look at the Napa halftime stats. JC, clearly this is all domination in all three phases for TCU. 330 yards to 31 yards among the stats that stand out and jump off the screen.
Yeah, no question about it. All lopsided in the favor of TCU. Like, we were able to run the ball, able to throw the ball, and for Grambling, you can look at their numbers and you can just tell that they just couldn't get anything going in the first half. Couldn't run the ball, couldn't really throw the ball. And, you know, the second half is all about adjustments, and we'll see what kind of adjustments Grambling was able to make to try to get some things going in the second half. And they'll be playing against a lot of the backups for TCU.
Casey Paul-Hall, 9 of 9, 201 yards in the first half. Half of that yardage went to number 82, Josh Boyce.
Well, he's a big play guy for him, and he's going to have a huge year. They like to just get him the ball quickly and let him do the rest. He's very athletic, very fast, a 4-3 guy. Gets a couple blocks down the field here, and now you see what he can do athletically and speed-wise. Big 66-yard touchdown run off a quick screen.
Has tied the TCU school record with 17 career receiving touchdowns. 2 tonight, 9 last season. Before the third quarter starts, down to the field, Emily Jones.
Just spoke with Grambling head coach Doug Williams. He said, this is a pride half for my team. This is Grambling. We are a proud bunch, and I want to see it in the second half. He said he'd continue to play his guys and wants to see him play hard. He said he'll learn a lot about his team here in the second half, guys.
Clearly, no one is going to wear Grambling and the heart and soul of the program on their sleeve more than Doug Williams, who played for Eddie Robinson in the 70s and has coached them twice. Took over for Eddie Robinson, won SWAC titles in his first tour of duty, and they rallied from a rough start to win one last year. Remember that the SWAC, they don't play in the 1AA playoffs or the FCS playoffs. They do have a SWAC championship game, and last year they defeated Alabama A&M 16-15 for their conference championship.
And Grambling is about legacy and tradition.
Yes, sir.
They've got 4 NFL Hall of Famers. They've got countless numbers of guys in the NFL. They're a prideful group, and I expect them to come out and play hard this second half.
Short kickoff, Fabian Carter running up to field it. Raymond James beyond the 20, and that'll do it. Wade Julian on special teams with the tackle. Casey Paul-Hall does not have his helmet on. By the way, new helmets debuting, and very snazzy. Sharp new helmets for TCU. 9 of 9 for Paul-Hall, 201 yards to the first half, 3 touchdowns for the junior from Brownwood. And so now we are seeing redshirt freshman West Mesquite High School Trayvon Boykin coming into the game. Dual threat as a senior in high school. He's going to hand the ball off here, and spinning and surging forward is true freshman BJ Catalan. Trayvon Boykin, as a senior, passed for 2,900 yards and ran for 1,800 and ended up with 58 touchdowns because he had 28 passing touchdowns and 30 rushing touchdowns. So the redshirt freshman, Gary Patterson, holds true on what he said with his halftime interview with Emily, that they would play Trayvon Boykin in the second half.
Yeah, and they like him. He's a very talented young man, but you know, they don't want to get any of their starters injured either.
Catalan around the ball for 10 yards a moment ago. Boykin on the quarterback keeper. And he's close to 10 yards and another first down for TCU with Tyler Smith, the rover, a junior for Grambling, making the stop. And this will move the sticks. Two plays, two first downs, 10-yard runs. First for Catalan, then for Boykin.
Yeah, and, you know, when we talked to Gary Patterson, he said that, you know, this game is more about just Grambling and beating Grambling. He's trying to prepare his team to beat the UTs and the K-States and then the OUs of the Big 12. And so he's got to develop some of his young guys and his backup guys, and they're looking at developing for the season.
Inside handoff. Back into the game. Tucker's in. Grambling tries to strip the ball from Matthew Tucker. Matthew Tucker runs for a first down. It's three plays and three first downs.
Yeah, and you can see just the front of Grambling still looks like they're very worn out, not firing off the ball, not being physical at the point of attack, and then missing tackles also. And, you know, all of those things equal bad things when you do them on a play.
16 on that run for TCU for Matthew Tucker. Wayman James is the leading rusher for TCU with 69 yards, including a touchdown. They have quickly, TCU, moved it to the Grambling State 41. A handoff running left. Andre Dean taken down by Tyler Smith. Tried to stiff arm out of that tackle, but Smith wrestles him to the turf after a 1-yard pickup.
And that time, Tyler Smith did a great job of maintaining leverage on the ball. He took on the blocker with his inside shoulder, kept his outside arm free, and then was able to come off and make that tackle.
Boykin, a handoff inside Andre Dean. Dean surges forward, picks up about four.
You can see TCU very content to come out and not do anything fancy, just run the ball. They know they're well in control of this ball game, so they're just going to come out and just let their backups work on executing some plays. And I don't expect to see them do too much, although here on third and long, they're probably going to have to throw the ball here to try to convert the first down.
Empty backfield formation, five receivers. And Boykin on third and six. We'll throw it inside to B.J. Catalan, a running back who was lined up in the slot. Jacardi Carter, middle linebacker, will knock Catalan to the deck. About 2 yards shy of a first down, a 4-yard pass play. And on fourth and two, we will see punting for the first time in his TCU career, Cale Patterson, a fifth-year senior. Now, we expect that true freshman Ethan Perry will eventually be handling the punting duties if there are more to be had tonight and, of course, going forward in the season. A highly recruited punter from Smithson Valley High School down near San Antonio. But Cale Patterson will get to punt here for the first time in his TCU career. And Anthony McGee will wave off the fair catch. That doesn't get near. And a bad hop. And so the numbers will not be good on Cale Patterson's first punt.
No, it won't.
Yeah, that bad bounce back up field means that Cale Patterson's first punt will be 13 yards. Again, we're talking about the guy behind Anson Kelter for the last 4 years, but an opportunity. Gary Patterson told us he wanted to give Cale Patterson the first punt. I think as much as anything is that as a head coach, he envisioned some concern with two true freshmen in the kicking game. And we've seen Overcom handle the place kicks, but they wanted to get Patterson that first punt rather than Ethan Perry tonight.
Yeah, and, you know, Ethan Perry, I was watching him in pregame, and he was definitely the guy with the much stronger leg between the two. And as a freshman, it doesn't matter when his first punt comes, whether it was the first punt in the game or the next punt. He's still going to be nervous no matter what, so you might as well go ahead and get that out of his system early.
Well, we'll see if there is another punting situation tonight, because that was the first one of the game for TCU. Every drive ended in a score until TCU let the clock run out at the end of the first half. After a one-yard run, DJ Williams under pressure, and he's just able to get the ball away. There's a marker down, might be intentional grounding. The ball didn't get back to the line of scrimmage, JC. There wasn't a receiver in the area.
Intentional grounding, offense, number four. Loss of down, third down.
Sam Carter, the strong safety, was putting the heat on DJ Williams.
Yeah, and you can see just coming right off the edge, and DJ Williams just throws the ball away, still in the pocket between the tackles, and just tries to get rid of that ball to avoid the sack. You see nobody even close to where he threw the ball and was in the pocket still, so that was an easy intentional grounding call.
And it moves it back 13 yards to Grambling zone 8. They need 22 on third down from their own 8. Williams from his own goal line. High pass incomplete for Musa Mahmoud. Incompletion. Williams is 2 of 8.
Just rushing just a little bit. Didn't follow through on the ball. That was an easy throw for him to make. Mahmoud is wide open, but just with all the pressure that he's been getting, he just rushes that and ball sails on it.
This will be a great field position, you would assume, at this point for TCU. There's a bit of a rush here. Carter got it away. It's a bad kick. Will bounce upfield, though, and will be killed right at midfield. 5 minutes gone by in the second half. That was a 43-yard punt officially for Fabian Carter. TCU in control.
It's in.
Fox College Football is presented by Frost Brewed Coors Light, the game's most refreshing beer. By Mazda, we believe if it's not worth driving, it's not worth building. And by Whataburger, proud to serve it hot and fresh 24 hours a day. Josh Boyce on a 66-yard touchdown pass from Casey Paul in the first half. One of the 6 touchdowns posted by TCU, 4 by their offense, special teams on a punt return, a pick 6 by Elisha Olabode. And from the 50, from midfield, is where TCU will start their second drive of the third quarter. Trayvon Boykin throws it out to the right side, and it is caught. David Bush with the reception. Redshirt freshman from John Tyler High School.
Seeing a lot of backups now for TCU in the game all over. And they have to do that because you got to prepare for the season. You got to get your backups some reps. And you know, practice is one thing, but a game, even a game like this, is completely different.
Yes.
To get used to the speed of the game. So you want to get those guys some reps as well.
So the first catch for David Bush, a handoff. Catalan went right, cut back left. It was second down and 3, and Catalan gains yardage for the first down, 5 to the 38. TCU has spent the last 7 years in the Mountain West Conference, and Gary Patterson's club won 77 games, including the 2010 perfect season, ending number 2 in the nation, winning the Rose Bowl over Wisconsin. But as you see, 11 or more wins 6 times, JC, and they won 6 of 7 bowl games, going twice to BCS bowls, and they lost one of those to Boise State and the Fiesta Bowl after the 2009 season.
And Gary Patterson has done a great job of building a program, not just winning a year, but you see all the consistent winning seasons. That shows that you've got a great model, you've got a great program, you've got a great system, and you're doing a great job of recruiting and coaching the kids up.
False start, offense. They didn't get set for 1 second, the whole team.
Randy Crystal, second penalty tonight against TCU.
He called that on the whole team.
That was different.
Yeah, the whole team, nobody set for a second.
Last 4 seasons, this is where TCU has ended in the Associated Press poll. 14th last year, number 2 after the Rose Bowl went over Wisconsin. 6 the previous year, and 7 when you go back to 2008. Twice a BCS buster from a non-AQ conference, but they have when Chuck Ninus, the then associate, the then interim commissioner, I should say, of the Big 12, when they had the press conference welcoming TCU to the Big 12, he said, "I'd like to welcome you back home." It was that great run in the Mountain West and the changing landscape of college football, and TCU being positioned for the opportunity to take advantage of that opening in the Big 12. And he said, Chuck Ninus said, "I'd like to welcome you back home, back in a conference with Texas, back in a conference with Texas Tech and Baylor." Great times here at TCU. Boykin, a pitch, DJ Catalan inside the 35 of Grambling at the 34. This will be a third down, needing six coming up.
And it's a win-win for everybody. The Big 12 gets a great institution in TCU, and then TCU wins because now they join a great conference. And obviously the financial payout and then the ramifications of winning the Big 12, I mean, you're looking at national championship possibilities if you can do that.
TCU, along with West Virginia, the new members of the Big 12 this season. Third down and six. Trayvon Boykin will tuck it under and run. Great speed, has the first down, slipped out of the tackle, cuts to his right, trying to make it to the end zone. He does, and he does.
My goodness.
Trayvon Boykin from 34 yards out and showing speed and elusiveness on that run.
You talked about his dual threat ability. This is not even a quarterback run. This is, he finds nobody open, and so he just pulls it down and watch him make guys miss. One, there's two, another cut back here, and then he's going to make another guy miss down the field and stretch out for the touchdown.
Overcrom with 7:15 remaining in the third quarter has put the Horned Frogs out in front 49-0. What a debut here in this third quarter. Trayvon Boykin going head first on the dive. Inside the pylon, he scores. Gary Patterson, the head coach at TCU, said he wanted to play his backup quarterback, Trayvon Boykin, in the third and fourth quarters. He's doing that, and it's paid dividends just a moment ago.
Sure has. You talked about him being a dual threat guy. Watch him right here, just a designed pass, but nobody open down the field. So he just pulls it down. You can see that he sees a lane, and now he's just a running back. Here's the dual threat part, and watch the vision. Makes one guy miss right here, but watch the vision. Great cut, number one, great cut, number two. And then now he makes one other guy miss and then just lays out across the goal line. That's just great athletic ability by Trayvon Boykin.
Redshirt freshman from West Mesquite High School, the Jack in the Box scoring drive. The numbers provided to us from our statistician, the great Bob Thomas. Five plays, 50 yards, 2 minutes and 44 seconds. And again, it is Boykin with his first collegiate touchdown. Does it on the ground. That's Matt Brown, by the way, number 10, who was the backup quarterback last year for TCU, ran it in six times. Brown has moved over to wide receiver. He's from Allen.
But still will be the third quarterback, so who knows? We may see him taking some snaps tonight.
Ryan DiNucci with the kick, a run by Justin Fortson. On the two, he starts it out to the sideline, out beyond the 20. They'll officially spot him out at the 21-yard line, 49-0 TCU. Here's a Mazda game break. Let's check in with Rick Renner.
Best finish of the day in Lawrence, Kansas. Chris Boswell nails a 45-yard field goal as time expires as Rice beats Kansas 25-24. Rice's first win of the Big Ten over a Big 12 school in 21 tries, guys.
Saw Tulsa play Iowa State last week. They've lost 18 in a row. Or 16 in a row after that loss last week against Big 12 schools. But Rice out of Conference USA breaking a long losing streak against the Big 12.
Yeah, big win for them after getting beaten pretty handily by UCLA last week.
Officially, the return came out to the 22-yard line. Dorrance Roberts started running back but didn't get a whole lot of time after the first quarter. Jason Verrett brings down Roberts, who only ran for 8 yards on 6 carries in the first half.
Yeah, it was tough going for him. It's still tough going for him right now, but Jeremy Runner came in and ran the ball a little tougher, I think, in that first half than Roberts. Roberts only 175 pounds, so tough to him for him to really get downhill and run with a lot of power.
A gain of 1. A pass to the left side from DJ Williams to Richard Wilson. And Wilson gets hammered out of bounds at the 25. 2-yard pass play for DJ Williams, 3rd completion in 9 attempts. Only 14 yards passing tonight for Grambling. Number 95 there, Devontae Fields, true freshman. He's had a big impact on the game tonight for TCU.
Sure is. 3rd and long, but you got to watch these defensive ends. Mapunga and Fields, they're going to be getting up the field trying to get after the quarterback.
Williams drops back, steps up in the pocket. Now he goes over the line of scrimmage. He thought about throwing and then obviously realized that he had crossed the line of scrimmage. So ended up stutter stepping out of bounds, well short of the first down, probably a full 3 yards shy. Scramble does net 4 yards upfield for Grambling.
Yeah, and just not enough time to really set up and look down the field. Devontae Fields is coming from off of one edge. Mapunga's coming off the other edge, forces him to have to step up in the pocket way too quickly and then get on the run. And then nobody opened down the field. So those 3rd and long situations are awfully tough for Grambling.
4th down and a punt for Fabian Carter. Preseason 2nd team all SWAC. To the 25, Deontay Gray stays on his feet. Then brought down near the 40. 15 yards on the return for Deontay Gray. We're going to check out the club level of the new Amon G. Carter Stadium with Emily Jones when we come back. TCU up 49-0.
Welcome back to Fort Worth, Texas. The TCU Horned Frogs making quite a statement in their season opener, the first game in the Big 12, and making quite a statement with the renovations here to Amon G. Carter Stadium. $164 million in renovations. We are on the club level here, seating outside between the 20s, and then you come inside. Of course, plenty to drink, plenty to eat, and plenty of places to watch the Horned Frogs in action, as well as check in on some of the other games around the Big 12. And gentlemen, it was interesting in talking to Gary Patterson about how this thing was built, and it was because of the relationship with Fort Worth. They have such a small alumni base that they have to rely on maybe people, residents here in Fort Worth that went to other schools that lend their support, and things get kind of dicey now because a lot of those were alumni of Big 12 schools. And he said, look, I'm fine if they cheer for us every game of the year except for maybe when we play their alma mater. He said, I'll take that all day long because they are part of what helped build this stadium. So it really has been a fun experience to be here tonight, and obviously the Horned Frogs making quite a statement.
That is tough and elusive running by BJ Catalan after the pass that he caught out of the backfield for 14 yards. And to echo Emily's sentiments, you know, very, very enticing shot of the club level. Obviously, it is first class, and we have not had a chance to say this enough tonight.
Beautiful.
This facility is first class all the way, JC.
Top notch. As good as I've seen anywhere in the country. I mean, this can match up and stack up with anyone, and they should be proud of what they've been able to do. And it's really going to help them recruiting wise going forward, and just great things going on here at TCU.
David Bush, the catch from Trayvon Boykin, and another first down for TCU from the Grambling State 46 down to the 28. So 18 yards on the pass play. I read an article this week where Victor Bashini, the chancellor here at TCU, was quoted, and he said that he had a lot of discussions with the architects from HKS, who, when they focused on the finish out, wanted it to be the nicest things possible, first class all the way. He said, hey, I have to admit that there were some things that they really had to persuade me on, because my natural inclination was to go a little bit more of a less expensive route. Timeout is taken here by TCU. And we will follow up more with that point about the stadium. We do have an in-game to get to on that. But first, in the game, a timeout is taken by TCU up big. and some sights from opening day of TCU in the Big 12 and here at the newly rebuilt Amon Carter Stadium. The game has cooperated with many great moments. J.C. Pearson, Raymond James, a touchdown in the first half. Josh Boyce scored a couple. Special teams just provided a touchdown. The defense has provided a touchdown. Perfect day for Casey Paul Hall and the TCU passing.
Yeah, everything has pretty much gone TCU's way today. I mean, from the off-the-field festivities to on the field, from the very start of the game, and they've made plays in all three phases, offense, special teams, defense, and they're still not done. But it's been all TCU today.
Trayvon Boykin, a backup quarterback, has spelled Casey Paul Hall throughout the distance here so far in the second half. Presumably will going forward. An inside handoff. This is first and 10 for TCU at the Grambling State 28-yard line. And a gain of two on that run. For TCU, this has been quite an odyssey. They were on the outside looking in when the Southwest Conference broke up. When it was announced in 1994, the conference stopped playing football in 95. And Baylor and Tech and Texas A&M then went on to the Big 12. TCU, along with SMU and Rice from the old Southwest Conference, went into the WAC in 1996. Gary Patterson was on Dennis Franchione's staff as a defensive coordinator for 3 years, then became the head coach in 2000. They moved into Conference USA in 2001 and certainly enjoyed success. Then into the Mountain West. In 2009, they went 12-1 and where they were a BCS buster, losing to Boise State in the Fiesta Bowl. And then finished number two in the country at 13-0 after the 2010 season, winning over Wisconsin in the Rose Bowl in 2011 after they had already accepted an invitation to join the Big East. The landscape of college football and college athletics shifted, and they were invited and, of course, accepted to join the Big 12.
And very happily so. And like I said, it's a win-win for both sides, the Big 12 as well as TCU. And that's what Gary Patterson said. He said, hey, we've won. TCU has won. Going to the Big 12, where they belong, and playing the teams that they're going to play and the financial ramifications, and all great for this university.
47, Tyler Smith for Grambling went out of the game. A pass to B.J. Catalan from Trayvon Boykin. This will get TCU first and goal on a gain of 16 yards down to the 9. Cedric Goins on the tackle.
Yeah, Boykin, just a good, quick decision out of 5 wide receivers. They split running back out and does a great job catching the ball. Catalan, we've seen him run tough, fast, with a lot of power, and now he shows that he can actually split out and catch the ball as well.
First and goal at the 9 for TCU in the last 3 minutes of the third quarter. Handoff, Dean from Boykin. Tried to spin out of a tackle unsuccessfully after a gain of 2. What has led TCU to this point in terms of that 17-year odyssey from getting left behind when the Southwest Conference broke up? It's been the success of Dennis Franchione initially, then Gary Patterson, of course, picking up the ball and running with it for the last 12 years. A renewed investment in athletic facilities here at TCU, the John Justin Athletic Complex, new weight room, obviously the renovation, rebuilding of Amon Carter Stadium. A great connection now between the folks in Fort Worth and TCU. Purple, the predominant color now, anytime that you're around Fort Worth.
And that's the biggest thing, is now the city is behind the university.
David Bush will score for TCU. Trayvon Boykin finds Bush on the left side, just shy of the goal line, and he totes it over to make it 55-0, TCU on top.
And Trayvon Boykin just gets the ball out of his hands quickly, and the coverage down the field, the secondary of Grambling just playing too far off. Look, nobody even covering the slot. It's just an easy, quick throw and catch, and he just has to turn up the field. I mean, that's just way too easy. You've got to get the linebacker over the top of him, or that safety's got to walk down, or it's a touchdown every time.
And David Bush gets his first collegiate touchdown. Boykin with his second touchdown pass of the evening. 2:10 left in the third quarter. TCU in front of Grambling, 56-0. The first football game for TCU under the banner of the Big 12 Conference. They'll play a conference game next week against Kansas. Gary Patterson, the head coach of the Frogs, with his thoughts on moving into the Big 12.
TCU's better. Fort Worth's better because of the Big 12, financially, all of it. I mean, reputation, everything. But, you know, Gary Patterson's job got harder, but that's okay. But, you know, the thing that allows me to not worry about all that is I know we came 15 years ago, I didn't feel like TCU and Fort Worth were together, and now they are.
Many people have been credited with the saying that luck is where opportunity and preparation come together. And TCU certainly had, there was an element of luck and of good fortune of being a top-notch program with all the wins whenever the opening came up with the Big 12. But the investment in facilities, the job that he's done as the football coach, a perfect storm has occurred here in Fort Worth, Texas, to allow TCU to make this move into the Big 12 Conference. And obviously everything going perfectly tonight.
Yeah, it has. And he said his job just got a lot tougher, but for every other head coach in the Big 12, their job just got a lot tougher also to try to prepare for this TCU football team, because it is a very, very good football team.
Justin Fortson on the return. Here's the Coors Light game summary. Frogs have scored on 8 of 10 possessions. The first half ended when they let the clock run out. They had one punt here in the third quarter. Paul Hall was perfect in the first half. Josh Boyce with 2 touchdown receptions tonight has tied the TCU all-time reception touchdown record. He is at 17, and of course, counting. When we talked with Gary Patterson yesterday, he said he envisioned there are two plans. There's the two-year plan where everybody has to get used to the places you're going to start going to on the road after this first down run here by Juwan Martin. And new quarterback Frank Rivers is in now for Grambling. There's the two-year plan of getting used to new stops on the road, new travel destinations, teams coming here and learning what it's like to come to Fort Worth. And then there's the 3 to 5 year plan in terms of recruiting different athletes, better athletes, and building the program that is a year in, year out competitor for a Big 12 championship.
No question, they're gonna be able to do that, obviously, but you know, they've got talent, and they've got enough talent, and they've got enough quality players to compete right now. You know, and I think he was downplaying it just a little bit, but they expect to come in and compete for the Big 12 championship. They didn't come in here, and he said that's at the top of the goal. You know, compete for the Big 12 championship, national championships. That's the expectations here at TCU now. Right. They've raised it to that level. So I think he was downplaying it just a little bit for us, but they want to win and win right now.
They're down in 7. Paul Dawson, the middle linebacker, transferred from Trinity Valley Junior College down in Athens to high school in Dallas at Skyline. Dawson made the stop on the short run. Third down at about 6 on the rollout. Frank Rivers, who did play in 7 games last year, and he completes a pass. Jeremy Hernandez paid for it, though, as he got walloped by Chris Hackett when he made the catch, but it is a catch for a first down nonetheless as they pick up 7 yards when they needed around 6.
And we finally see them move the pocket. For the first time, we see them move the pocket, get the quarterback out on the edge, and give him a chance to throw the ball. You can see a good job that time by David Bush getting just enough yards up the field so that when he made that catch, it was a first down.
The third first down tonight for Grambling. Jeremy Hernandez with a catch of 7 yards. Rivers throwing and almost intercepted, but the tight end Johnny Hedgman makes the grab and maintains possession. That's the final play of the third quarter. A dominant night for the 20th ranked TCU Horned Frogs. They have been rolling since the first 2 minutes of the game. They lead it 56-0 after 3. You're watching Fox College Football. Fifteen more minutes remaining. It's all about the Frogs tonight. TCU 56-0 lead over Grambling State. Let's check some Heisman hopefuls. As you look at this list here, Matt Barkley from USC, Le'Veon Bell at Michigan State, Monte Ball at Wisconsin, and quarterbacks of the Big 12, Geno Smith at West Virginia, their idol this week, Landry Jones in Oklahoma playing tonight. I know the yardage number isn't big, JC, but when Matt Barkley goes to the media capital of the world, throwing for 6 touchdowns against Syracuse in a game at MetLife Stadium. Pretty big news.
Big news, especially after the game that he had last week against Hawaii. Now, Matt Barkley, you got to think now. I mean, he went in as the favorite, and you know he's not giving up anything right now. That's for sure. Got to be the heavy favorite right now, but it's early.
Juwan Martin stopped to the line of scrimmage on the first play of the fourth quarter. Grambling looking at third down. They need just a skosh less than 5 yards to get the first down. Geno Smith doesn't have a chance to state his case today, but really opened up with a nice week against game against Marshall last week.
And he's going to have a huge year in that offense of Dana Holgerson's in his second season. Going to have a huge year, but another guy that's going to pop up on that list is Colin Klein from Kansas State.
Yes.
Very, very impressive today watching him play. If there's a most valuable player award, it has to go to Colin Klein.
Throttled Miami today. Looping pass hung up and was almost intercepted. Deontay Gray nearly gets on the scoreboard again. He returned a punt in the first half, but he's close to an interception and going the distance.
Yeah, and pressure gets here on the quarterback. Just got to get rid of this ball a little quicker. Doesn't get a lot on it. And Deontay Gray almost came up with the pick six, but quarterbacks for Grambling been under pressure all night long. That time Frank Rivers has got to know that it's coming. Got to get that ball out of his hands.
John Lewis belted the quarterback Rivers after the throw. Fabian Carter punting. Deontay Gray, that is, returning. And a big hole. He's got one tonight, and he slips through. 2 tackles. He's got the punter Carter to beat, and he held him up enough and got him to the turf. 60 yards on the return. Deontay Gray, and it was the punter, Fabian Carter, who did just enough to keep him out of the end zone.
Man, this is a true freshman. He's already returned one for a touchdown, and great cut right here. Can cut at full speed, he's got great vision, and then again, cuts back across the grain. Just not quite able to outrun everybody. The punter, Fabian Carter, able to pull him down, but man, another great return by Deontay Gray. When you have that kind of weapon on special teams with this offense and this defense, oh my God, watch out.
An eye-popping number I'll give you here, 32 yards per punt return is what Gray has averaged tonight and 5 opportunities to return. Timeout is called with 13:45 remaining. TCU will burn the second of 3 second half timeouts. Let's check it out again. Deontay Gray off to the races. Big return for the Horned Frogs.
I said, yes, you do.
TCU with a 56-0 lead. You're looking at the club level of the newly rebuilt Amon G. Carter Stadium. TCU 20th in the Associated Press poll. Here is the top 10, JC. And the story that jumps off the page here is number 7, Georgia, losing right now to Missouri in Missouri's first SEC game, 10-9.
Yeah, that was a huge game for Missouri at Missouri. All the intangibles in their favor, but only at halftime still, so a lot of football left to be played there in Mizzou.
USC 1, Alabama victorious, bye week for West Virginia. Arkansas only a 2-touchdown lead right now over the Warhawks of Louisiana Monroe. TCU took a timeout before they had their first down snap at the Grambling 20. Trayvon Boykin on a pitch to B.J. Catalan, got a block ceiling off the edge, and Catalan bolts to the sideline and has a first down run of 11 yards. Interesting note here, J.C. This drive set up with great field position because of another punt return by Deontay Gray, who has set a TCU record. He breaks a 65-year-old record for punt return yardage in a game. Lindy Berry had the old record. And 160 yards of punt returns tonight for Deontay Gray is a new school record.
In his first game.
Yes. B.J. Catalan fights off 1 tackle in the backfield, but he is eventually brought to the turf by Grambling for a loss on first and goal. Had a big loss of 4. Second down and goal coming up with 13 minutes remaining. It We talked a lot tonight about TCU joining the Big 12. The first game for any of their athletic programs here at TCU under the banner of the Big 12, they played New Mexico in a women's soccer game on August 17th. They have not played any game against another Big 12 member institution. That will happen next week against Kansas. The ball slipped out of Boykin's hands, and it is Eric Harper who jumps on top of it for Grambling. That's TCU's first turnover tonight as we see Boykin going back to pass and loses the ball.
Yeah, just slips out of his hands as he's going back to throw it. Might be a little slippery, getting a little chilly out here, and the ball just comes out of his hands. Right there, no question that that's a fumble. Grambling able to create the turnover.
A fumble, not an incompletion. So TCU's perfect passing night stays intact. 16 of 16 between Pahal and Boykin for 272 yards. However, they do commit a turnover. Eric Harper with the recovery. Harper played at Louisiana Tech. He's a grad student at Grambling and has a year to play at Grambling. Mostly a tight end in his time at Louisiana Tech. 9 catches as a tight end for La Tech and a couple of touchdowns, but now converted over to defensive end. Oh. Upended on that run at the 20-yard line. Big hit there as Cedric Skinner goes down.
Yeah, I think that might have been Sam Carter coming up from a safety spot. Wow. Comes up low and hard. Upends Sam. Upends
Cedric Skinner.
Cedric Skinner.
Freshman from Overland, Louisiana. The fourth different running back that we've seen on the field carry the ball for Grambling. He gained 4. Has a hole up the gut. And blast out for first down yardage. Skinner to the 29.
You gotta like the way Skinner's running. He's running hard. It's the fourth quarter. This whole Grambling squad is tired, down big, but there's no quit. And that's what Doug Williams is looking for. There's no quit. He wants to see the guys that are going to continue to play hard, because those are the guys he's going to feel good about putting on the field going forward.
It's the fourth first down for Grambling State compared to 24 for TCU. And an inside handoff gains 5. As Skinner with another carry. Down to the field to Emily Jones.
Well, we showed you the club level, but really the crown jewel perhaps of this $164 million renovation is the Founders Club. And these are 6 suites, only 6 in this whole place, that hold 40 people apiece. The price tag, $15 million. So really the athletic department said it's because of these 6 donors that really made this renovation possible. Names like Moncrief and Justin, named synonymous with the Fort Worth community and loyalty and commitment to TCU. And in addition to the 40 seats that you see on the outside, a suite on the backside of that, and then a common area for all those 240 Horned Frog fans to hang out.
And monuments to those 6 donors outside the bowl of the stadium, sort of similar to that Yankee Stadium Monument Park feel. You know, that gives me an opportunity to get back to the thoughts of the Chancellor, Victor Bashini, and you know, I got a chance to get a little tour of the Founders Club yesterday. You did as well, JC, and it's just it's beautiful. And that was part of the area where they really accentuated the finish out. And Victor Bashini, the Chancellor, said that sometimes what I wanted to do was go the less expensive route, but the architectural firm HKS at Dallas, they won the budget battle every time out to go with the more expensive choice. And he said, it was hard for me trying to manage the budget, but now that I've seen it, I'm glad that I went that direction. The finish out has been just first class, spectacular.
No question about it. Can't be anything but ecstatic at the way that the renovations turned out, because like you said, everything is first class, as nice as I've seen anywhere in the country, and they can be very proud of what they've done here at TCU.
Seating capacity 45,000, and they can sell between 2,000 and 3,000 SRO, standing room only seats, for big games as well. Frank Rivers, the quarterback, hands it off to Juwan Martin, and he will go up the gut for 2 yards. More from Emily.
Well, Mark and JC, I thought it was interesting in talking to Gary Patterson yesterday how he mentioned the past in which they had to walk roughly a mile to and from practice at the soccer fields. And he said he didn't want these teams to forget about those times. So every once in a while, he'll load them all up, make them make that hike over to the soccer fields to remind them of kind of what this program was built on.
And with the game having gotten out of hand, obviously a lot of the seats have emptied out, but 45,112 is the announced attendance for this first game in the rebuilt Amon Carter Stadium. John Kuntz from Alito Jr., backup defensive end, made the tackle. Mentioned earlier that TCU's first conference game for any sport will be when the football team takes the field against Kansas next week on the road. Virginia will be coming in here for the next home game. Virginia and TCU played in a bowl game back in 1994, the Independence Bowl. Frank Rivers, a pass over the middle, incomplete. I recall that Virginia has had a disappointing visit to the state of Texas in the past. They lost a game in the 90s on a 50-yard field goal at the final gun by Phil Dawson in Texas. So they'll be in here to play TCU in a couple of weeks. But still just under 8 minutes remaining in this one, and Grambling after the incompletion for Frank Rivers will have to punt.
Yeah, they have to punt. Put a couple pretty good plays together, got a couple first downs, kept the clock moving. So some positive things that they can take and build off of, especially from that last drive.
Deontay Gray has been electrifying in the punt return game tonight. Won't get a chance here. Fair catch of the 23. 36 yards on the kick by Fabian Carter. TCU with a 56-0 fourth quarter advantage. 56-0 TCU over Grambling State. Mark Folliwell, JC Pearson, Emily Jones on tonight's broadcast on Fox Sports Southwest and Fox Sports Southwest Plus. On the Big 12 scoreboard, Kansas State walloped Miami 52-13. Nice win in the battle for the Cy Hawk Trophy for Iowa State. That was not three field goals. There was a missed extra point after a touchdown. 9-6 Iowa State wins. Rice upset Kansas and Oklahoma, beating Florida A&M in the third quarter. Texas Tech. Now Texas State had a nice win over Houston last week, but they're on the wrong end of a 55-10 score from the Red Raiders. And Texas at the half against the triple option of New Mexico leads 17-0.
Today, Kansas State awfully impressive today. Beats Miami.
B.J. Catalan on the first down handoff. And one other game you saw, Oklahoma State has a late win tonight on the road in Tucson against Arizona in what could be a track meet, and always one of those challenging games when you're on the road team and you have to wait so long.
Yeah.
Much like the game you did last week on Fox Sports Net between Oklahoma and UTEP.
No question about it. Those late night games, especially those teams on the road, can be a challenge. And Oklahoma State put up a lot of points last week against Savannah State, so it'd be a much tougher test to see how good they truly are against Arizona tonight.
Haven't seen much eye formation tonight for TCU, but we see it here in a late game situation as B.J. Catalan spins forward on a second down and 10 run.
Yeah, and all they want to do here is just put some first downs together, keep the clock moving. It's third down now, so probably going to have to throw the ball, but if they can, they want to just keep the ball on the ground and keep this clock moving and get out of this game healthy.
4 yard run there. 6.5 minutes remaining. TCU needs 6 on third down, and Boykin will throw it. Crossing over the middle, David Porter catches for the first time tonight. Sophomore from DeSoto, who had 7 grabs last season. Came up short of the first down, though, by 2 yards, so 4th and 2, and now it will not be the true freshman, the highly recruited Ethan Perry, but the 5th-year senior, Cale Patterson, will get an opportunity for his second punt tonight. can't just have one punt for 13 yards.
Yeah.
He had a short field to work with when he had that punt in the third quarter, and it took a bad bounce. So.
Yeah, got to give him a chance to unleash one.
That's right.
Like he just did.
He did. You're exactly right. Fair catch. Back to the 23-yard line. 46 yards on Cale Patterson's punt. Timeouts with 5:38 to play. Fox College Football is presented by Academy Sports and Outdoors. Right stuff, low price, every day. By Ford, it's the Built Ford Tough Truck event at your Texas Ford dealer. Ford is the best in Texas. And by GEICO, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Visit us at geico.com. Nothing TCU leads here at new Amon Carter Stadium. Band is obviously having a good time, and of course, one of the great things of Saturdays during college football season is tailgating and food. Our crew putting together some great shots. Not sure if that was jambalaya or gumbo, whatever it was.
We could use some, because I'm getting pretty hungry up here.
5:38 to go as this night winds to its conclusion here very shortly. There is an inside handoff for 2 yards. All right, now on the club level, let's go back and see. There's a lot of shrimp. I don't know, that might be some sort of seafood stew of some.
Look like some sausage in there.
That's what made me think jambalaya.
Yeah, look like some rice. Whatever it was, looked pretty tasty.
Two orders of that to go, please.
Yeah, please.
Our statistician Bob Thomas just requested a third. 2 yard gain on that first down run for Grambling with 5 minutes remaining. A toss sweep, Cedric Skinner. Well, of course, one of the storylines coming into the game, and now it's about to obviously come to fruition, was that Gary Patterson needed one victory to become the all-time winningest coach in TCU history, passing the name of the legendary Dutch Meyer, who led TCU from 1934 to 1952. Sugar Bowl, Cotton Bowl, two national championships. Those were some glory days for TCU football then. There's some glory days for TCU football now, and Gary Patterson is about to have his name etched in the TCU record books alone on the victory list.
No question, great accomplishment. He said that, you know, he'll think about it for a few, but then he's going to go right to KU. They got Kansas next week on the road, and business as usual, and maybe after the season he'll have time to really enjoy it. But he wants to remember all of the senior classes that helped make that possible too. He said sometimes you forget some of those guys and the faces, and he was really, really emotional talking about those guys, because, you know, he said he has trading cards made up of all the senior classes and wants to remember all of them.
Well, they've been part of building something very special here. The 11th punt, and it is the wobbliest of the night for Fabian Carter of Grambling. Stick around and find out who tonight's Whataburger What a Player of the Game is next, with TCU up with 4 minutes to go. Four minutes and 2 seconds remaining for Gary Patterson of the TCU Horned Frogs from a season-opening victory, and playing a big part of it, the Whataburger What a Player of the Game, freshman defensive back Deontay Gray, who was sensational in the punt return game tonight, JC.
He sure was. From the first punt on, returns that for a touchdown, did a great job, broke the TCU record for punt return yards in a game. And this is his first game ever playing for TCU. So that tells you what kind of player this young man is going to be for TCU. And almost outside of that, almost had a pick six to go on top of that.
From Westside High School in Houston, in his first collegiate game, Deontay Gray with 160 punt return yards on 5 returns. That included a touchdown with a minute and 59 seconds gone by in the game. He put TCU in front with a 70-yard punt return. You know, it really was a little bit more yardage than that. He caught it at the 30, but his momentum, remember, brought him backwards another 3 or 4 yards before he turned it up the field.
Man, great start for him. Now the expectation level. They're going to expect him to do that every week.
What can you do for an encore?
Yeah.
From the 42 of TCU, a run upfield of 5 yards for B.J. Catalan. Rushing-wise tonight, TCU is at 224 yards going into this drive. They have eclipsed, as of their last drive, and then with five more tacked on now, 500 yards of total offense tonight. 505 is the number for TCU compared to only 70 yards of offense for Grambling. Trayvon Boykin has played the entire second half at quarterback, the redshirt freshman, after Casey Pahal threw for 201 yards, going 9 of 9 in the first half, and he had 3 touchdowns as well.
I think Gary Patterson has found out a lot about his team tonight and the freshmen. That was his biggest question mark, is how were the freshmen going to play and respond in a real game, and they all responded admirably. I mean, they made big play after big play. Devontae Fields, the defensive end, made his presence known immediately, had a tremendous first half, talked about Gray and on and on. I mean, this freshman really stepped up today.
Because of how the second half has played out with B.J. Catalan on the field, he has more carries than anyone tonight, 12 carries, 55 yards. A keeper on third down by Trayvon Boykin. Zips up the field and has the first down, gaining 8. Let's check tonight's Coors Light game summary. 2.5 minutes remaining in this 56-0 TCU lead. 513-70, the total yardage. TCU has scored on touchdown passes, on a run, on an interception, and a punt return. The numbers for Pahal and, again, Josh Boyce, in case you missed it, becomes at least ties the TCU record for all-time touchdown catches. Corey Rogers and Mike Renfro, along with Josh Boyce, now stand atop the TCU record book at 17 touchdown catches. David Bush went in motion. Boykin faked the handoff. Boykin keeps it and fights out of an ankle tackle. Was able to get away from Tyree Hollins and then was brought down near the first down marker. Probably 9 yards and a yard shy. At the 34 of Grambling, and TCU in a position where they may only have to snap this 2 more times before they can officially put victory number 1 in the books for the season and number 110 in Gary Patterson's coaching career, setting a new TCU mark. Nothing was the halftime score. And a couple of more touchdowns have been added on here in the second half. Boykin ran one.
Timeout. TCU.
Boykin also threw a touchdown pass earlier, and he is one of many freshmen who have played tonight, 12 true freshmen. Boykin, a redshirt freshman, has also contributed. Here's Deontay Gray, a true freshman. We've already talked about his impact on the game tonight. Great punt return here. That's the touchdown run for Deontay Gray. B.J. Catalan. You know, this is why yesterday Gary Patterson said he had some unknown aspects about this team. And I know it's an FCS team that they're playing tonight, but to see these true freshmen and redshirt freshmen perform on this stage tonight, it's got to feel good.
Oh, it's got to feel good. And he said he felt like his freshmen were talented, but to do it in practice and do it in a ball game, completely different things. And now they've been able to do it in a game.
And you're talking about true freshmen and redshirt freshmen that you have been able to recruit in the aftermath of going to 2 BCS bowl games and with the announcement of joining the Big 12. So obviously those are big recruiting tools to bring in better quality players. And so they're seeing that. That's being reflected in the play of the young guys tonight.
Absolutely. I mean, being in the Big 12, being on national TV all the time, these facilities, this new stadium, all of those things tie in together when you're out recruiting those big-time players, and it's just going to help this program grow and continue to get better and better.
A kneel down to end the game. The final 20 seconds will go off the clock. One last note to pass along: with the 17 of 17 tonight passing, TCU sets a new FBS record. The previous best perfect game passing was Iowa against Northwestern in November 2002. But the quarterbacks, Paul and Boykin, go a perfect 17 of 17 tonight as TCU caps the inaugural game of their new Amon Carter Stadium with a 56-0 shutout over Grambling.
Yeah, couldn't get much better for TCU. Everything went their way tonight, from special teams to offense to defense.
They will have a different experience going on the road to Lawrence, Kansas, and a mad Jayhawk squad next week after Kansas lost on a last-second field goal to Rice today by a score of 25-24. But as with all teams, they've got the 24-hour rule. Time to savor this one and enjoy this 56-0 win as we head down to the field and check in with Emily Jones. Emily?
Well, Coach, win number 110 for you, passing Dutch Meyer. Can you just put this one in perspective?
Well, you know, I guess if it's going to be one like this, you'd like it to be an easier one. But, you know, we got a long road ahead of us. But obviously, you know, I'm very flattered. Been here a long time. Obviously, as a head coach, you don't get a chance to do this because you don't, not all of us get a chance to stay in one place and do that. But, yeah, really excited, and I'm just thankful for everybody that's been a part of it.
To have it culminate here tonight with the unveiling of this stadium, your first game in the Big 12, kind of fitting?
Oh, yeah, you know, you couldn't. You know, it's been, I tell you, I'm glad it's all over with. You know, there's been a lot of check marks here in the last 5 days, and just to be a part of it now and see how we move forward here in the next 10, 15 years is going to be important.
You've always talked about the relationship with this community, with Fort Worth, Texas. What do you have to say about this community now?
Well, you know, Fort Worth, I love them. You know, they've done everything. They've raised me. And so to be here 15 years and all the coaches, all the players have been a part of it, I can't thank them enough.
Speaking of youngsters, 12 freshmen, true freshmen, played by you tonight.
I told you we're going to play a lot and we're going to have to grow up, but we're going to get ready.
All right, Coach, thanks so much for the time. We appreciate it. Congratulations on the win. Number 110 in his career, passing the legendary Dutch Meyer. Guys, we'll send it back up to you.
Thank you, Emily. Great job tonight down on the field and checking out the site. The new stadium sights and sounds. JC, a final thought on a big win and a big night, a perfect night for TCU.
Yeah, congratulations to Gary Patterson and just the unveiling here at TCU. And great start to the Big 12 season. Next week they get started with Kansas. And this is a very, very good football team. I think will contend in the Big 12 this year.
Well, it is not often that the script is written beforehand and it plays out precisely as all of the parties wanted it to on the TCU side of things as they roll to a big victory tonight at home against Grambling. Coming up next, it's College Football Saturday's postgame show with Rick Renner, Pat Jones, and Matt Mosley. For J.C. Pearson, Emily Jones, and our outstanding crew here in Fort Worth, I'm Mark Followill, saying so long from the new Amon G. Carter Stadium, where it is a 56-0 win for TCU over Grambling State. You've been watching Fox College Football.